This is a film I made of Jonathan Williams, who was a Black Mountain poet. That is, he went to Black Mountain College and studied under Charles Olson, etc., in the 50s. He was also the publisher of the Jargon Press, University Television, that is public television, North Carolina, asked me to do a film about him, or I suggested it, that they do a film about him, and they sent me up there to Highlands, where he was, and we made this film, which subsequently won Best Documentary in the North Carolina Film Festival of 1975. Hope you like it.
Jonathan Williams grew up in Buncombe County in the Great Smoky Mountains of North Carolina. His early training seemed to earmark him for a career in the visual arts. He studied painting with Carl Knaps at the Phillips Gallery in Washington. He worked for 2 years in etching and engraving with Stanley William Hayter at the Atelier 17 in New York. He spent some time in photography and drawing at the Institute of Design in Chicago. And when he came to Black Mountain College in 1951, he spent the summer studying photography and painting with Robert Motherwell, Ben Shawn, and Aaron Siskin. Black Mountain was at that time under the dominating influence of the poet Charles Olson. It was Olson's sheer power as a teacher that drew Williams away from the visual arts and into poetry and publishing.
Charles Olson taught the notion that you must not be abashed in front of disinterest, that if you had words worth putting on paper and worth publishing and worth presenting to a community, and Black Mountain, as I say, was a community of a particular kind of sympathy. And that's what you might say the avant-garde, if you want to use that term, is always represented. It's a community of a particular kind of sympathy. And Olson thought that, and I think he's right, he said, one of the things he said, the artist is his own instrument. And if the artist is his own instrument, and if he's a poet and wants to publish, then he simply learns how to use printing presses, learns how to get ink on paper, makes the effort to get stuff out. So this was, you know, lesson number one, learning to use the tools. Second point was that why should anyone, if one is a writer, beginning writer, why should anyone outside of one's friends, so to speak, outside of the community, take any interest in what you're doing? I mean, it's almost impossible, and as I say, why should they? Why should they? But the arts are nothing more than a community. Now, Black Mountain was a place in time and fact. After we left it, most of us who were nurtured by it have made our own community for ourselves. And in the case of a literary man such as myself, you do this by writing letters. One becomes a man of letters, and also one becomes a reader. And so the community goes as far back as Hesiod and Homer, and as wide-ranging as correspondence in Kyoto and Zambia and so on. We make up our community in time and space. And so we don't have to have, like, Black Mountain. I mean, that's where it starts, but that's just the beginning notion that the arts are this community for friends. And I publish books for those who I consider my friends, most of whom I've never met, but I don't publish for what they call an audience, because I don't know who that is, and I'm not interested in merchandising. I'm interested in getting things to people who are, so to speak, friends, who want them.
The things which Williams has chosen to get to his friends reflect the range of his tastes and interests over a period of 25 years. Black Mountain was a place for Williams' Jargon Press to begin. Then the names were Charles Olson, Robert Creeley, Joel Oppenheimer, and Dan Rice. The names which interest Williams have changed since that time, but it remains his intention to make books of a particular kind of impact.
I'm interested in the notion of creating the books of childhood, the magic books, over again. And I wanted to make the poetry books of my adult life as exciting for other people and for the poets as the experience that one had as a child of going to get the first Oz book, or to buy Tolkien's Hobbit, or Tom Swift, you name it, Wind in the Willows. I mean, I wanted those books to be, as so to speak, sacred objects. I wanted to make the books befit the poem. In American society, poetry has been underestimated to such an extent that I wanted these books to do service to poetry. I wanted to clear up as much static as possible. I wanted to make the books as limpid, as clear, almost a typography that disappeared because the message came through loud and clear.
In an effort to gain a market for the poetry and to compound the impact of his books, Williams drew on his substantial background in the visual arts to add a graphic dimension to Jargon publications.
You have to really entrap people to make them interested in poetry. And again, something that befits the words. For instance, there were 6 poems out of a book of Sherwood Anderson's called Mid-American Chants. Well, what can you do with 6 poems? I got 12 photographs to go with the 6 poems of the Mid-American landscape by Art Sensabaugh, which gave us an excuse for a book. So it restored what little of Anderson I felt needed restoring, and it gave me a chance to present the work of Art Sensabaugh, which almost no one knew at the time. So we make this big book that's 2 feet wide and opens up to 4 feet wide and gives you the real feeling of Southern Illinois. I've always found that you couldn't, quote, illustrate, unquote, poetry, but you could take the work of a photographer and set it next to the work of a poet and make a sort of a new thing. Well, I mean, this is what art's about. As we know in the 20th century, if you put one thing next to another thing, a third thing happens, or it's the spaces in between that are important. A montage is really what it's about. I think, yeah. Hugh Kenner, who was one of our best critics, once referred to Jargon as the custodian of snowflakes, and it's the best thing that's ever been said about Jargon. It does indicate that poetic culture in this country is evanescent and deliquescent as snowflakes are. If they aren't caught and turned into books, almost everything around us can disappear without trace. Certainly the civilization that we're used to is disappearing around us almost without trace and being replaced by a world that seems to be run by franchise operators. And this is also true in poetry. So it's something that has to be fought just as much as you would fight for conservation or ecological balances or decent politicians. And a quality of poetic language has to be maintained in this country or else it's all over. The deracination, definition, root, a growing point, an organ of absorption, an aerating organ, a good reservoir or means of support. Vernonia glauca, order, compositae, these tall perennials with corymbo sims of bright purple heads of tubular flowers with conspicuous stigmas. I do not know the ironweed's root, but I know it rules September. And where the flowers tower in the wind, there is a burr of sound, empyrean. The mind glows and the wind drifts. Epiphanies pull up from roots, epiphytic, making it up out of the air.
As a poet, Jonathan Williams claims the right to use any bits and pieces of the world mosaic he sees fit. All material is there to be used, retuned, and resurrected in other forms. For instance, in the concrete poems, a variety of experiences surface as poems which have no sound, only an appearance.
A pileated woodpecker's response to 4 dogwood berries. 3 bears of different sizes dreaming from 3 hollow logs on Mount Kephart in the Great Smokies on a warm day in February. 2 topiary chops or clipped greens is the world's first poem attacked by pruning shears. In the first case, the gardener was drunk and ran the shears down the middle of the bushes. In the second case, he trimmed them in the 18th century manner to which the poem has become accustomed. My first mentor was Charles Olson, one of whose preachments and most famous statements was by ear. In other words, the whole basis of his poetics was to make a sound experience. Ian Hamilton Finley, my second mentor, said exactly the opposite. He said that the important thing about poetry was not its sound at all, but its appearance. The look of the words, the eye operating in a very clear and lucid way, and looking at the substance literally, the letters, the shapes and forms of letters, that one could manufacture a poetry which had no sound in it at all. Well, these are two diametrically opposed views. Both of them are true, both are valuable. And of course it is true that the two resources that poetry uses are one's abilities to see clearly and to hear very sharply. These are the materials of words, their look and their sound. And to be able to make all of these things articulate is one of the great things that Charles Olson gave us, among many others. But in recent times, for my own work, Olson and Finley have been two persons from whom I've learned a tremendous amount. This is a section from a long poem called A Celestial Centennial Reverie for Charles Edward Ives, the man who found our music in the ground. The section is called simply The Alcotts. It's in four parts. One, always doing something within. Two, sturdiness and substantial virtues, even if he couldn't make a living. Three, under the Concord sky, there sits the little old spinet piano Sophia Thoreau gave to the Alcott children, on which Beth played at the Fifth Symphony. A common interest in common things and common men, a tune the Concord bards are ever playing, while they pound away at the immensities with a Beethoven-like sublimity. Four, not much besides the memory of that house under the elms. In this world, in the next,
So Jonathan was a great guy all of his life and a huge supporter of poets till the end of his days, which happened a few years ago. There's a copy of the film at the Museum of Modern Art's Film Library, that is the Donnell Film Library, which Bill Sloan acquired back in 77. And please feel free to leave comments if you would like. Thanks.